Hey everyone, welcome back to the channel. I am John, and in this video, we're gonna go over these two do-it-yourself electric control panels behind me that power my electric HERMS brewing system. I have one 240 volt panel that powers my boil kettle, and one 120 volt panel that powers my HLT. I'm gonna talk about what they are, give you a real high level overview of how they were built, and then show you an example of how they work. But before we get started, I'm going to take these off the wall and head inside and give you this overview. Now, if you've seen other videos of mine, you know I brew on this system often, and these panels have been a great addition to my home brewery the past couple years. I'm able to easily bring up my brew days up to a boil and also maintain precise temperatures during mash. I'm really happy with how these turned out. All right, so now that I have this off the wall, we'll head inside and go over this overview. All right, here are my two electrical control panels that power my electric HERMS home brewery. The one on the right is the 220 volt that powers my boil kettle, and the one on the left is the 120 volt version that powers my hot liquor tank. Before we get started, know that I'm not a licensed electrician, and this video is for entertainment purposes only. If you decide to build something similar, make sure to really understand your local electrical codes and research and understand how all these components work together that make up an electrical control panel for an electric brewery. So what is an electrical control panel for an electric HERMS home brewery? These control the power output that goes to electric kettles. And here's an example of an electrical element that's inside my electrical kettles in my HERMS system. This is what's called a boil coil. And what I like about these boil coils is one, they're really well made. Two, they're easy to mount in the kettle. And three, I really like how I can disconnect the power cable on these electrical elements when I'm not using them. It makes it easy to really move the kettles around in my home brewery. And also, I think it's a great safety feature. When it's disconnected, I know there isn't any power going to my electrical kettles. I've seen other home brewers that build their own electrical elements, and here's an example of a water heater that can be used to power an electrical kettle. And in combination with things like an electrical box, you can put these two together and mount this on the side of your electrical kettle, and it seems to work great for a lot of people. And for this overview, let's go ahead and start with the 120 volt version. And then we'll jump into the 220 volt version example. For both of these electrical control panels, I use a large hard plastic enclosure for the box. If I were to build these again, I would opt for the metal enclosure simply for durability. These have worked out great the past few years. I haven't had a lot of problems. The only problem I've had with this plastic enclosure is I did pull one of the power cables out of the box one time when I pulled too hard on the electrical cable. Other than that, I've been really happy with how these performed. I would just want something a little bit more durable if I built these again in the future. And for the design of these enclosures, what I did is I just gathered all the components I planned on using for these enclosures and placed them around on the outside and inside the enclosure to get an idea of how they would work together and the room I would need to place all of these in this enclosure. And once I was happy with the layout, what I did is I taped the entire box and drew the areas I needed to cut out for things like the switches, the PID, the LCD screen for the amp and voltage meter, the heat sink, and all the connections at the bottom. Now let's go over at a real high level on how this 120 volt control panel works in all its components. So how this works is power comes in through the bottom and goes into a 20 amp, 120 volt breaker on the side of the box. I can turn on and off the power at any time in this control panel with this breaker. From there, it goes into what's called a DIN rail system. DIN rail is a German standard of electrical engineering. What I like about the DIN rail system is it's really easy to work with and keeps everything nice and organized inside your enclosure. So at the bottom of my enclosure is a flat metal bar, which is the DIN rail. And all the components of the din rail system look like this. They kind of snap into the din rail. And on the din rail, I have terminals for my hot leads, my ground leads, and my neutral leads. I have also have components that have a fuse. I have a din rail fuse component that powers things like a lower voltage thing, like a PID, the LCD system on the front of the control panel that shows me my amperage and voltage. And also I have fuses. I have a 10 amp fuse for the outlet at the bottom of my electrical enclosure, and also a contactor. A contactor is a switch that turns on and off electrical current. So for example, on the front of my control panel, I have an on-off switch that goes to my electrical element. And if this is on, this turns on the contacts in my contactor that sends power to my solid state relay. A solid state relay is a switch much like the contactor, but it's able to turn on and off power very quickly. So it's able to send power to my electrical element and reach precise temperatures using the PID. And how this works is I can either set my manual power output using my PID, or I can use the sensor that's also connected to the PID in the kettle. And what the PID does, it sends signals to one side of the solid state relay that turns on and off the power side of the solid state relay that sends power to the electrical element. This is a heat sink. Here's an example of the heat sink that sits on top of the solid state relay. For my electrical enclosures, I opted for a heat sink that sits on the outside of the box. And what this does, it dissipates the heat from the solid state relay. You can imagine if the solid state relay is turning on and off very quickly to heat your electrical element, it is going to get hot. So you need what's called a heat sink to dissipate that heat. So once the PID starts to send signals out to the electrical element, I'm able to monitor the power output through this LCD panel. This was probably the most important part, or the component, I think, of this build. And I didn't think about it at first. I just thought it would be a neat add-on to my control panel. But a really important safety feature, I'm able to see if power and how much power is being sent out to my electrical element through this digital display. If it's on, I know that power is being sent out to the electrical element. And if it's off, I know there isn't any power being sent out to the electrical element in my kettles. If you're enjoying this video so far, make sure to hit that like button and subscribe for more content like this in the future. Your support really helps this channel grow. And now for the 220 volt version. It works very similar as the 120 volt version, but all the components of this control panel support 30 amps and 220 volts. So taking a look on the outside of this enclosure, it's laid out exactly like the 120 volt version. I have a on-off switch for my outlet at the bottom. If I were to design this again, I would actually remove the outlet on these boxes. For my system, I use a switch right on my pump. So I rarely, if not never, use the power outlet option on the bottom of these control panels. I also have the same PID, which I can control manual power outputs to my electrical element. And I also can use a sensor that's connected to my boil kettle and use this PID to reach specific target temperatures. I also have the same on-off switch, which I can kill the power to my electrical element at any time when this electrical control panel is turned on. I think this is a really important safety feature, and I would build this one into any control panels I would build in the future. And taking a look inside the box, it looks almost identical to the 120 volt version, but again, all of these components support 30 amps and 220 volts. So how this works, power comes in through the bottom, just like the 120 volt version, and goes into a on-off breaker mounted on the side of the control panel. If power is on this breaker, it powers the DIN rail system. On the DIN rail, I have my grounds, my neutrals, my hot leads, and also fuses for the components that use lower voltage amps for the control panel. Another upgrade to this DIN rail system is the 30 amp contactor, which is the switch that turns on and off power that goes to the electrical element. And I also have a fuse here, a breaker on the DIN rail, that 10 amp breaker that goes to the outlet at the bottom. So if power is flowing through the on-off breaker into the DIN rail system, and if I have the power on that turns on this contactor, again, how this works is a lower voltage or amperage signal goes into the contactor, and if it's turned on, it closes the contactor and sends power to the solid state relay. The solid state relay in this control panel is, I believe, a 40 amp solid state relay, and my 120 volt is a 25 amp. And the heat sink on this 220 volt version is quite a bit larger because this creates more heat than the 120 volt version. If I were to build these again, I probably would just use the same 40 amp solid state relay in both these control boxes, because I think it would just be an added safety feature for the 120 volt version. But again, how this works is if power is turned on and power is being flowed through the DIN rail system into the contactor, and if the contactor is turned on, it sends power to the solid state relay. And depending on how the PID is programmed, the PID sends signals to the solid state relay and turns on and off power going to the electrical element in the kettle. Okay, we have the two control panels mounted back on the wall, and for this demonstration, I am going to use my 120 volt control panel to power my hot liquor tank and the 220 volt control panel to power my boil kettle. Now for the 120 volt control panel, I have the temperature set at 125 degrees. So what's happening is there is a temperature probe mounted on the side of my kettle, and the PID is reading the temperature and ramping up the temperature to 125 degrees. Once it hits 125 degrees, it will maintain that temperature until I adjust the settings. And for the boil kettle, the 220 volt control panel is set to 100%. So it's going to try to bring up the water from 78 degrees all the way to boil. So we're going to let this go for a little while and check on the temperature shortly. Now these PIDs are packed with features, and I'm just showing you a few options I typically use on my brew day. You can set these up to finely tune how it brings water up to temperature, and also add things like light indicators and alarms that alert you during the brewing process. One feature I wanted to show you while the panel is on is the on-off switch while there's power in the control panel. You'll notice that the amperage and voltage display is on, so I know there's power going to the hot liquor tank. If I turn this switch off, the voltage amperage display turns off, and this tells me that there isn't any power going to the kettle. Just a neat feature I added to my control panels. And on these displays, this is set to automatically bring the temperature up to 125 degrees. And on this one, you'll notice that there is a power setting. I can ramp the power setting up or down, depending on how fast I want to bring the water up to temperature. But this is set to a manual setting, and this is set to the auto-tune setting. The boil kettle is starting to come up to temperature pretty quickly. Since this is a more powerful control panel, the temperature is coming up a little faster than the 110 volt version. So I'm going to let this get to about 155 degrees and then turn the panel off. Okay, it's been a few minutes and my boil kettle is now coming up to about 154 degrees at 100% power. So that shows you how powerful a 30 amp service can bring water up to temperature. I'm going to go ahead and shut this one off because I don't want to bring this up to a boil, but we'll keep the 120 20 volt version going until we hit 125 degrees and maintain this temperature for a few minutes. So we'll go ahead and shut this off. You'll notice my display went off. Now I know there isn't any power going to this kettle, and this will stay at 155 degrees and start dropping in a few minutes. Okay, the hot liquor tank has hit 125 degrees, and you'll notice that the display for the amperage and volts is at zero. What's happening is that the PID is sensing the temperature of the kettle, and when it dips below 125 degrees, it'll start to send power to the kettle to maintain this temperature. If it overshoots 125 degrees, the amperage will be at zero. So currently there isn't any power going to the kettle because we hit our target temperature. One thing to note when brewing on electric brewing systems, it's extremely important to use ground fault circuit interrupters for your circuit breakers. This is a really important safety feature that is a must on electric brewing systems. If you've enjoyed this video, make sure to share, like, and subscribe, and drop a comment below. That's it for this video. See you next time. Cheers.